toujours le même phénomène. Mes pas vers toi me ramène. Toujours les tiens viennent vers moi.
Hello everyone. Welcome to a new episode to France, a trip to France. I wanted to introduce myself. My name is Natalie Scott, and some of you already know me from wearing different hats. And today the hat I'm wearing is the French teacher who actually took a trip with a group of wonderful students from Hopkinton. And we took a trip to the French Riviera, Provence, and the Alps. And it was such a beautiful trip that we wanted to share this with you and bring you a little piece of France back as well. But right off the bat, what I want to tell you is that these students, I'm very proud of. They have been taking French lessons through the Senior Center with me since before COVID. And we started in class, and then with COVID, we shifted over to Zoom classes. And so they've taken French with me for over 2 years now. And when things started reopening, they asked me, oh, should we take a French trip together as a class? You know, what could we do? And I had looked at different options and sent them different links of things. And I said, you know, my husband and I, we signed up for this particular trip with this particular company. You have choices. You can do whichever you want. But they all chose to come with us. And that was such a wonderful thing, because we realize what a special group this is. And if it were up to me, I would give them all the title of beautiful ambassadors, because they were absolutely a great pleasure to travel with. So I'm very proud of the progress they've made and all the things they've learned and this eagerness to continue learning, which is amazing. So let's take a look at what we have done together as a group. So this was obviously a private tour. There were enough people on the tour that we could turn this tour into private, which means that it was just my class, our students, with some family members and very dear friends, but it was our tour. So we had a little bit of, you know, things that we could add ourselves to the tour, which was really nice. And so we'll start with Nice. And so Nice is on the Côte d'Azur. This was our, we landed at the airport of Nice. And of course, this was the month of May 2022, and the weather was already very nice during that time. Actually, it was very hot through the 10, 12 days that we were there. And Nice is off the Mediterranean Sea, and this is what it looks like from afar. Beautiful beach in Nice, a lot of pebbles on the beach. So that's a little tricky to navigate if you're not used to the pebble stones on the beach. But the water is very warm. It's like bath water. It's very blue as well. And Nice is really off the coast, so you get to see a lot of coastline. And Nice is very colorful. As you can see, the materials they use for housing is also very red. They have that special clay that's very red. But this is the old Nice, so you see older constructions. There's all kinds in Nice. And you have what they call also le vieux Nice. And so that's the downtown. So what is fun about Nice? You have a newer portion of Nice, which was built recently with renovated buildings. And then you have an older part of the city where they have cafes and restaurants and also markets, a lot of markets. And there is even an antique market every morning in the Vieux Nice. And so if you like antiques, it's a fun way to spend time in Nice, is to go through those antique dealers who have stalls on the market. You're not far from the beach, you can go to the beach, and you have La Promenade des Anglais. And what's really nice about Nice, they have this, it's a T, it's like a tram, it's le funiculaire, it's a train, fast train, or well, not so fast, but basically you can hop on anywhere in Nice and get to your hotel. It actually crosses the whole, all of Nice, so you can get off and on wherever you want to go to certain areas of the city. It's a fairly nice city to walk. Everything is very pedestrian friendly. And you can walk, but if you wanted to avoid walking, you can take le funiculaire, which goes around Nice and you know, to different parts of Nice, because you have to know your way too. There's a lot of small streets. It's easy to get lost in Nice. But you can always find your way back to that train. Everybody knows where to get to the stop. It's the view. So when you go to the south of France and Côte d'Azur in particular, one of the things that I'm not able to show you right now or give you the sense of is the smell that you have. Nice has a very particular smell. It smells like the sea. You have that salty smell. But there's a lot of rosemary and thyme, wild rosemary that grows around. So it's very, you can smell those flowers, those plants around you. A lot of great foods too that is being cooked through Nice. Anchovies, there's a lot of anchovies and pizza with anchovies, or some dishes, la pissaladière, which is a type of pizza made with onions and anchovies. So it's prevalent when you walk around in the street. And then the flowers, a lot of beautiful flowers that have a lot of scent, like le mimosa, which is a tree with little, I don't have any pictures here, but you can actually see the green, the pines. That's also a smell. So there's a lot of smell and the sound of the Mediterranean on the stones with the pebbles rocking back and forth. That's very typical of the south of France. So I can give you the scent and the noises. I can only give you the pictures, but it doesn't give it justice. As you will see, but this is what you see, and you know, like I was telling you, this area of France has a lot of flowers, and we'll come back to talking about the flowers. But you can see cruise ships coming in as well. It has a big harbor. All right. So here's back to the smell. So we took an excursion to Saint-Jean-Cap-Ferret, and on the way to going up the coast, there is a perfume factory called Fragonard. And Fragonard is very well known in France. And this brings me back to the flowers. They grow a huge amount of flowers in the south of France. And of course, with flowers and scent of flowers comes perfume making. And this was not part of the planned visits, but I had talked to the tour director and said, hey, we're going by, could we stop? And we were there early enough that we were able to stop at the perfume factory of Fragonard. That's in Nice. And so we got a guided tour through the perfume. So the first thing is they educate you to the local flowers that grow in Nice, and also the imported flowers that they use in their perfumes. And they have you identify some scents. And so they test you and say, okay, what does this perfume smell like? And apparently one of the person in the group had the nose. And I was nicknamed the nose, so I'm the person in the group that apparently had the nose to retrieve some of these flowers from the perfume. So it was very funny because the lady kept saying, so where's my nose? Where's my nose? I was her nose. But you can see that it's a big industry. They make soap, and they make children's soap right there, the little duck. And the south of France for me is very dear. And because I grew up, I spent all my childhood summers in the south of France. So as a kid, I was familiar with the soap. I got a soap for my bath. instead of a rubber ducky, it's a soap ducky. But it brings back a lot of memories. And through my classes, when I teach my students, some of these childhood memories kick in with the culture and with the words that we talk about. And so I had mentioned to them, you know, the south of France. And I think that the interest that got built from that was through my childhood, and they wanted to experience the same things that I had mentioned. So this was a really fun visit. And of course, at the end of the visit, we all bought perfume. Fragonard makes perfume for the big houses of France, like Chanel, Lancôme, etc. But once you give the labeling to a big house like Lancôme and Chanel, you then crank up the price of your perfume. So Fragonard makes excellent perfume under their name Fragonard, so you could buy extremely good perfume for lesser money, not inexpensive. It's still, you know, it has a It costs a fair amount of money, but it is not nearly as expensive as the big houses of Chanel and Lancôme, because they produce it under their own name. So that was the attraction, of course. And so we made it to Saint-Jean-Cap-Ferrat, so it's just up the coast towards Italy. So you make your way from Nice towards Italy, you get to Saint-Jean-Cap-Ferrat. We did a beautiful hike through the rocks along the coast, and you will see, this is the walk we took to all the way to the lighthouse. And it's very rickety coastal, it's a coastal line, but it's very rickety. So it's difficult to, you can go fishing there, but you can't really dive or swim in there because it's very rocky. But there is a sidewalk that you can follow. And when you get to the end of this hike, you end up with Neptune's statue right there fighting an octopus, I think. But the view that you take in while hiking is just outstanding. And of course, you hear the cicadas. That's another particular sign of being in the south of France. You hear a lot of cicadas everywhere you go. And the evening, we headed to Monaco. This is it's actually a small country built on a rock. So Monaco has a little bit of a story. So what you see here is the marina, but I'm going to show you. So this is the royal palace. So there's a prince, la Principauté de Monaco, who lives in that palace with his family. As you can see, it's very compact. Monaco's it's an independent country, tucked between France and Italy. It's independent. It has some agreements with France for protection. But it was created basically very early on in the Middle Ages. So in 1215, Monaco actually was a colony of Genoa. So Genoa was in Italy. And in 1297, so the Grimaldi, the House of Grimaldi, which was a house in Italy, retrieved to Monaco on the rock. And they did it through a ruse. So here you see the defense system, the old, you know, the cannon with the cannonballs, and there's a restaurant right there. But here, this is what I wanted to show you. François Grimaldi is credited with the creation of Monaco. And this is in 1297, through a ruse. So the House of Monaco had different knights and fighters that were fighting, you know, all these different houses in Italy. It was not Italy. It was not Monaco, and it wasn't France the way it is today. The House of Grimaldi, François Grimaldi disguised himself as a monk, a Franciscan monk, and he tricked this area, pretending to be a monk, and then he managed to seize this rock, the Monaco rock. It's a small area, right? He seized that through a ruse, and he became then the Grimaldi who governed over Monaco. Monaco today is a constitutional monarchy, and there's a prince, le prince Rainier, le prince Albert now. Prince Rainier was his father, who actually married Grace Kelly. We'll see all that. So all this is still very present in Monaco, the history, and so they have a statue of one of their ancestor to the current Grimaldi in power. And as you can see, he is dressed up as a Franciscan monk. And this was the ruse, and that's why it's called the malizia. It's a ruse that tricked people, and this is how he managed to seize Monaco. Now, Monaco also has a museum, oceanography museum, because one of the princes of Monaco was very interested in science and marine biology and so forth. So they have a foundation, and the foundation was very much financing and helping the Calypso. If you know the Calypso, it's Jacques-Yves Cousteau, so one of the big marine biologists that they were in France. You must have known about Jacques-Yves Cousteau. He brought back a lot of the specimen that they have now in this museum and institute. So Jacques-Yves Cousteau worked for the Institut Oceanographique de Monaco. And so he started it as well. He contributed, this is one of the first submarines And I don't know if you know this, but Jacques-Yves Cousteau, who is the French marine biologist, is the creator of the oxygen tank that scuba divers use to go and dive deep into the ocean. So he created that. And so they got the funding. A lot of contributions were made to the institute and to the museum, and a lot of it under his living days. As you can see, a nice octopus at the entrance of the museum. Monaco's known for its casinos and races, Formula One races. As a matter of fact, the day we went to Monaco, the day before they had a race, a Formula One race. And so they were still cleaning up the streets and the spectator arena, because they set that all up for spectators to watch the race. As you can see, big cars in front of the casino. So that's what it's known for as well. It's very small and it's very, very built. As you can see, this is a casino with the big cars and people gambling. Now, one interesting thing, residents of Monaco are not allowed to gamble. And Monaco residents are very, very rich people. There's no taxes on income or, and so you're gonna wonder, how do they finance everything? So a lot of it comes from the casino and the taxes, the corporate taxes that they instill on companies that may have profit. 25% of the profit come from overseas, then they get taxed 33%. But the residents don't pay income taxes or interest taxes or capital gain taxes. So it is, you can see there's definitely affluence in this little tiny country. This is a church, well, actually it's a cathedral of Monaco, where Grace Kelly, one of your American actresses, married Le Prince Rénier in 1956. So they have a picture and a dedication, but this is the church. Well, I say church because it looks small, but it's a cathedral, the Cathedrale de Monaco. It's gorgeous. And this is the marina. So you can see Monaco is super small. It's really, you can just walk around in half a day. Before I move on to Moustier-Sainte-Marie, Monaco is a fun place to visit. You can do this in one day. It's not far from Nice. Beautiful. The Museo Scenographique is definitely a great place to visit. So you can do the casino, the museum, have a nice dining, visit the church. But you can all do this all in one day. We were there just a few hours, and we didn't go inside of the museum, but we managed to get an idea of what the town looks like, and then we could go inside the casino to look at some people gambled. But it was just interesting to see how it plays out. And another day we went to Moustier-Sainte-Marie. This is on our way to Les Gorges du Verdon. And the Gorges du Verdon is called the Grand Canyon of France. It's an adorable little village in the mountains. So again, this will have a lot of little stairs to get there. But it's just, as you can see right here, so you have to go up, and it's very mountainous, and somehow there's a beautiful little village inside of the mountains. You could have lunch there and lots of homemade ice cream places. We did another hike there, and we went all the way up to this mountain. You could see already the beginning of the gorge, the Gorges du Verdon. And this group was awesome. They wanted to try and see everything, so ain't no mountain high enough for this group. And as you can see, it's not for the faint at heart. Some people went all the way up there. Some people stopped a little before that, before going too high up. And this is where you smell the rosemary and the thyme and all of these juniper bushes. A lot of people go just pick herbs out in the mountains just to make their bouillabaisse. Because that's another thing that you can experience when you go to south of France. When you on the menu, they have bouillabaisse, which is made with tiny little fish from the Mediterranean Sea, and you need several species of different fish to make the soup. Everything gets grinded down, but one of the things that you put in the soup is all these spices that you find around you. And as you can see, Gorge du Verdon, so there's a rive gauche, the left side of it, or the rive droite. And this is what you see when you start. So we had an awesome driver. You really have to know the area well, but the roads are pretty narrow and you go up these high mountains. And this is the, you start seeing the river that goes to the lake, Le Lac Sainte-Croix. But the view is just outstanding and the water is just so blue. Now, I remember doing this as a child. The water levels were much higher, when I grew up. So this was, for me, very shocking to see. You see this white rim on the side? That's usually covered with water. We already were entering drought season. This was only May. It was very hot. And we already were experiencing drought conditions, which we usually don't see until the month of July. So this was very unusual and quite shocking for me, having seen this area as a child. It looks very different than it did back then. Like I said, you can see how the water is receding, but it's outstanding and beautiful. So now you get to the Lake of Sainte-Croix. So this is still this is Provence, and you can see it from above when you're in the mountains. Another area, another village we went to is Roussillon. Roussillon has a mine, La Mine d'Ocre, Les Sentiers d'Ocre. And you probably recognize this. You see this type of color in the tiles and in the construction of the south of France. But it is also used in the cosmetic industry. So this powder is so fine and orange, and they use it for different purposes. And so it was really interesting to go visit the mines. Some of these rocks are just made of that orange. Actually, your shoes when you walk around are covered with this fine powder of orange. It's kind of neat. You could, if you didn't have time to do your makeup that day, you can just pick up and put your blush on, and that's just like the way it is in your box. As you can see, the group is starting to get ready. You have to enter the museum, this particular museum, through the back of this path right there. And that same, so the next day we did head out to Avignon. And Avignon is known for Le Château des Papes. And so one of the main things, if you're in the center of Avignon, this is what you see, Le Château des Papes. It's a beautiful fortress. This is the main common in Avignon, lots of churches. But you have this castle, and then you go up here, you have this beautiful park in the back of it. But this was the garden of the popes. And Avignon became very, very important in the 14th century because for political reasons and due to the fact that there was a lot of instability in Rome at that time, there were 9 popes that succeeded to each other, and their main headquarters was Avignon. And so Avignon became, for a while, from the 1309, the center of Christianity. And so you can only imagine how popular Avignon became in that time, because a lot of pilgrims or people who were traveling back and forth between Italy and Spain would stop in Avignon. And so it became a very renowned place for not just pilgrims or people of faith, but it hosted a lot of writers and, such as Petrarca, which is a humanist writer. So Avignon has a lot of history. Here we have, this is the park I was telling you about. So there's green areas for people to enjoy, a big park, but this belonged to the castle as well. At one point it wasn't open to the public, but it is now. And Avignon, everywhere you look, you have constructions that date back to the Romans. And you see this bridge right here. It was very important because it would link France. It would allow people from Spain and Italy to cross over. And it is not in use anymore, but they kept it just as the way it was. And this is a bridge, the Pont Saint-Benoît, which inspired the song. If you learn French, you would be bound to learn the song, Sur le Pont d'Avignon. That's the bridge that inspired the song. But what you don't see in the picture, there's another bridge that was built, a more modern bridge that's in use for cars and people now. They don't use this bridge anymore because it's failing. So you can still cross the river. But Avignon is just an outstanding historical city and lots of markets and fun places to visit and museums. We're not far, when we were in that area in Provence, Aix-en-Provence or Nice, we're not very far from Les Fontaines du Vaucluse, which is not far from Le Pont du Gard. And so it's a lot of water and fountains in Provence, and the water is coming actually from the Alps. We call this Les Alpes Maritimes. This is actually water that's melting from the snow in the Alps and make its way to Provence. So Jacques-Yves Cousteau tried to investigate. When you get to the end of this water trail, the fountains, you can see the water comes from this big, deep hole. And it is believed that Jacques-Yves Cousteau investigated to see how deep this hole was, but he never found the bottom of it. So we don't really know how deep this is. But it is a beautiful area. You hear the water streaming, coming from this big hole and making its way down towards Provence. And the Romans, their construction helped dispatch the water to different areas of the south of France. So the Pont du Gard is a patrimoine UNESCO. It is protected by the UNESCO because they don't want to damage it. It used to be open to the public. You could walk on top, but you can no longer do that. So it is a protected site of France. France has many protected sites, like Le Saint-Emilion, Le Palais des Papes from Avignon, that's on the list of protected sites of France. Arles, which we will see later, Le Canal du Midi, all these sites are protected. That means they're very much monitored to make sure they remain intact, not polluted, not destroyed, and maintained properly. But this is a bridge that, well, you can walk, but this used to carry water from one side to the other side of the banks to dispatch water through Provence. And we went in the same area. We went to the area called Le Château Neuf du Pape. So this was the original castle where the Pope was, and he moved. He had a newer castle built in Avignon. But the original was here. And with this castle comes a huge amount of winemaking. So it was land where they grew grapevines and to make wine. So you're going to tell me, well, how do they get all these castles? The church had all these castles. We'll talk about this in a minute. But this is what's left of that castle. The denomination of Château Neuf du Pape is very particular to this area, and it has pebbles. The river brings these pebbles due to the makeup of the land and the lime from the river. It has earned its denomination of Château Neuf du Pape, where they grow wine. And so there's a very popular wine called Château Neuf du Pape. It is un cru classé, so that means it is a recognized recipe that carries over many centuries. They make different types of wine, the white wine, which a lot of people don't know, and the red wine. The white wine is not exported. It is only a local production, and it's very hard to find because it's very limited amount. The red wine you can find even on the American market. It's a pricey wine. And the rule of thumb is when you buy a bottle of Château Neuf du Pape, you really should wait at least 3 years. It is a wine that gets better with age. And it has a special cork, special bottle. So when you talk to French people and say, well, we're having Château Neuf du Pape, that's a great honor. It is not an everyday wine. It is a wine that you open on special occasions. And in this particular town, Château Neuf du Pape, there are some really good restaurants like Go et Milo, which are recognized labeling of top restaurants. We were lucky enough to have a meal in one of those top restaurants, and it's a little hole in the wall. It didn't look like anything until you sat down and tasted the food. Then you realized you were in a very special place, but it was overlooking the vineyards. And so the restaurant's called, if you ever go to Châteauneuf-du-Pape, make a reservation, you need a reservation. It's called Le Verger du Pape, so the Orchard of the Pope. And so it was a really nice town, nice landscape. And we were outside because the weather was so nice. It's an evening, overlooking the vineyards. It was just heaven on earth. And so now we're making our way to Camargue. So Camargue is further south, closer to the Spaniard area. So we're getting closer to Spain when we go down that way. So it's the opposite way of Monaco. We go down the other way. And in Camargue is known for horses, bulls, and mosquitoes. Camargue has a lot of swamp areas. They grow rice because of the swamps, but it also attracts an awful lot of mosquitoes. So we were there at the very early, it was the beginning of the summer. So it was decent. There were some, but not too bad. If you get there in the summer, it's much worse. But we did visit a park called Le Parc Ornithologique du Pont du Gau. And so it is a protected area, and they have revived a lot of different species of birds. So we stopped at that park to see what type of preservation work they do with the birds. So this was really interesting. Now you can see the flamingos. They are pink based on the food that they eat. They eat shrimp, so they get pink. They're even more pink when they start flying. You see the pink under their wings. They make a funny noise when they fly too. You could hear them take off. But you can see some buzzards and all kinds of, it was an amazing park with lots of different species. And we had a guide who explained the different species, what they're doing, their nesting habits. And but it's called the Parc Ornithologique du Pont du Gau. And it was really fun. I mean, here's our guide. She's explaining to us certain habitat and birds. You see the flamingos. And it was so lively with so many birds. At one point, the birds were so close to us flying overhead. I'm like, oh my God, it felt like Jurassic Park. This is what it felt like. So we were laughing so hard because you could see birds left and right and all kinds of different birds. It was really amazing. It was definitely a great stop. The bull, you have statues of the bull. So why is the bull so known? So Camargue has a little bit of the tip of the Spaniard. So the bull is a popular animal in Spain. And so Camargue has corrida, they have bullfighting. They have the training of the horses. They train horses to go and, you know, herd cows and bulls. They also eat bull, and we had a bull lunch. And you're going to tell me, well, what does bull taste like? It tastes like beef. It might be a little bit more beef-like in terms of taste, a little more pronounced taste, but it is just like beef. And so that's what they use as meat. They have a lot of meat dishes based on the bull. They also have the fish soup. So we had a fish soup as a starter because they're so close to the sea, of course. As you can see, we chose to have a dip. It was such a hot day. You know, people had their bathing suits on, could go and swim. The beaches are beautiful with lots of seashells. We picked up a lot of beautiful seashells, different from the ones that we find here at Cape Cod. So it was a lovely lunch, very hot. We went to a market there, and Camargue is really known for its fauna and flora. It's very different from the rest of the Riviera. It's very particular. You see swamps, mosquitoes. So that's the thing. If you do go to Camargue, bring your mosquito repellent with you. And here we are in the Provence area, so not so close to the sea anymore. We're making our way inland in Provence. And we have here, I took this picture because this is a bridge that there's a lot of lavender growing in Provence. And so this is the bridge that some lavender pickers would use to bring the lavender to the stores or to treat the lavender or sell the lavender on the market. And this is also a bridge that Van Gogh chose to paint. So it was interesting to see. We followed the footsteps of two big artists when we were in Provence, to see when you go to Arles, and we're getting closer to Arles in this area, it was Van Gogh. If you went to Aix-en-Provence, yeah, you would see a lot of art and plates dedicated to Cézanne, who was another painter. But you are in Arles here, and Arles is really the town of Van Gogh. So even the cafe where he had his breakfast and drinks once in a while that he painted is there, and it looks just the same as his painting. This is an inside court of, it's no longer a hospital, but it used to be called La Maison Santé de Arles. So it was a hospital, for a mental institution for people who had trouble, mental health issues, like Van Gogh, for instance, spent some time there. He even painted it. And they tried to keep it just the way it was in his days, but it is no longer a hospital. It has all kinds of different businesses in there. And so because it's already established and built, and these are old buildings, there were no bathrooms for ladies and bathrooms for men. So they have a lot of unisex bathrooms in those areas because there's no space to make two different kinds of bathrooms. So it was funny because the ladies were like, oh, there, the men are in the ladies' bathroom. Like, no, it's allowed. So it was a bit of a culture shock to go to the bathroom in that area. But all good. They came out and they were fine. And so it's beautiful, as you can see, with lots of flowers and perfect time of the year. May is great. It wasn't supposed to be so hot. We kind of hit it on an exceptional year. But what you see is like all these flowers and scents and butterflies. It's really beautiful. And now in Arles, Arles is loaded with Roman architecture. And these are things that were built under the Romans and stayed to this day. So you have the theater that is still there. So they sometimes put up a play. You can see they have those cameras and they have the whole gear, particularly in summer. They start setting it up. A lot of plays happen there. And you can watch it like the Romans did back in the days. So it's amazing. But if you have the eye and you walk in a town like Arles, you can pick up on small little reminiscences of the past. Like, I don't know, there's so much history in that town. And so it's amazing. But then you get to the amphitheater and you really realize that. So you have these modern constructions in the back, but you still have a lot of Roman infrastructure that stayed. Hence, you can't add another bathroom or expand. You have to work with what you have, the spaces that you have. And so they really want to preserve what the Romans left behind. And this is why sometimes you have to adapt. You can see it from different angles. It was blue sky. It was just gorgeous. But it was amazing to see. And some of these stones had little prints of oysters. And, you know, we were like, oh, wow, it must come from, was the sea all the way to this area? So there's different theories, but the stones that they used came from the sea. And I'm gonna show you, Les Calanques is an area where the Romans took some stones to build some of their infrastructure. And this is why you see in some areas of this amphitheater little prints of seashells. It's very cool. And if you had the eye and you would have noticed that, you're like, oh my gosh, it makes sense. One of the areas we went to is l'Abbaye de Sénanque. It's a monastery. Of course, there's still some monks in there, so we had to, you know, there's areas that were closed off to the tourist, and you had to remain quiet in some areas when we get closer to their quarters. But their industry is really lavender. So you have fields and fields of lavender. And when we were there, the lavender started blooming. So it wasn't as blue as it could have been. If you had waited June, it would have been in full bloom. But we can see the buds starting. And so you have these fields of lavenders. And it's a big part of their industry. They make lavender oil, lavender soaps, lavender sachets to put in your laundry. all kinds of lavender products that are, of course, they also sell the oil to make the perfume industry. Some of the perfumes are made with a little bit of lavender extract. So you have all kinds of produce, but a lot of perfume and soap making in that area. One of the days we also went to Gordo, le village de Gordo, as you can see, built up high on the mountain. It's amazing to see that these houses are built in the rock like that. It takes some getting used to because you need to be in pretty good health to go up and down the stairs. A lot of stairs and climbing and going down. Not necessarily air conditioned, but the way that the houses are built, it stays really cool inside of those stone houses. So their industry is, they sell a lot of herbes de Provence, which they use, you know, which they use in their cooking, which is the herbes de Provence is those herbs that grow wildly around you, but they turn it into a produce that you can use in your cooking. Like I said, lavender, olive oil, there's a lot of olive trees in that area as well. And then wine making. And you have the boris, so these are the ancestral constructions made with stones, pebbles. You still see them, but this dates back to prehistoric times even. And so, but it's just beautiful views, beautiful sights, a lot of hiking opportunities. and here we are in Aix-en-Provence. So Aix-en-Provence is a big town. It's a student town. There's a lot of schools, colleges, lots of visitors, you know, students from England learning French, art students from Italy. I mean, you have all kinds of students, l'Université de Aix-en-Provence. And this is really interesting because the artist Cézanne owned a house. Now, Cézanne was not a prolific painter, and his family wanted him to be a banker. And he hated the bank industry. His family was well off. He was more inclined towards art. So he started off as working in the banking industry, and he absolutely hated it. And so he decided one day that was it. It was not for him, and he started painting. But he had a house built in Aix-en-Provence. He designed it. And because he was well off, you can tell that by the style of the house that he picked for himself. It has the several layered roof, the tile roof, which we call a Genoise, and the Genoise was a sign of richness. And he designed the house the way he wanted it. There's something interesting I'm going to show you in a minute. But the house fell in disarray after his death. The ancestors let it go, they wanted to sell, and nobody wanted to buy it. And so there are some admirers in America of the painter who created the funding to help to buy the house, because it was sold to a private owner who really wanted to do something else with it, and they wanted to protect this. So they managed to gather enough funding to buy the house from this private family, and they donated it to the University of Aix-en-Provence, and they turned it into a museum or an area for the art students to be able to learn about Cézanne. And so now it's a museum. It's become a museum. It's no longer a private house. It was donated to it belongs to the University of Provence. And you can see that nothing in there was altered. It was kept exactly the way that the painter had it, with his coat and painting coat, his hat, his stick to walk around, his umbrellas when he went painting. Some of his work, some of the vases that he painted. So it was really neat to see. These are some of his work that are being portrayed there. And one of the things that he painted the most is La Montagne Sainte-Victoire. And he painted it many, many times with different colors, as you can see right there. We did hike the Mont Sainte-Victoire, but he was obsessed with it. So he tried the lighting. The lighting can change so much. But he painted it. But one other thing, so I don't have a picture, but he had his house built. There's a huge long window, very narrow long window in his house, and I don't have it in there. But he had it built because when he was working on a very big piece, like, you know, sometimes he would paint a huge portrait, this was a way for him to be able to slide his painting through the window instead of bringing it down the stairs. And so that was the particularity of that house. It had a lot of features that would help the painter either move a painting or bring in a painting or set up his canvas. So that was really interesting. But I'm sure you can now look up some of the things that he painted. And he did some nudes, but he never really had a nude person in front of him. He used a lot of these wood skeletons that he used to feature. And then he kind of created the rest. So it was the structure of the body, but he was basically painting people out of his imagination. So it was really interesting. And so in Aix-en-Provence, Aix-City is a big city, very pedestrian-friendly, lots of great restaurants and a lot of glace artisanale, so ice cream, homemade ice creams. And then you see fountains every now and then. And these fountains date back to the Roman times. This fountain had so much calcium built around it that it looked like a big rock, just spouting water. And so apparently a few weeks before we arrived, the erosion of the water helped discover a piece of the fountain. So there's probably a beautiful structure of these snake or fish spouting water, but it had been covered by the rock for years, and all of a sudden the fountain is revealing itself. So they were mentioning that. It's like they hadn't seen this in years, the structure of the fountain. So they can't wait to see more. Obviously, there's probably a Roman structure underneath this rock. But this is all calcium deposit or lime. And now we find ourselves in Cassis. So Cassis is an excursion that we took. We were going on a boat ride to see the calanque. The calanque is the word that the French gave to those lime rocks, coastline, where the Romans cut big chunks of rocks out to build some of these amphitheater and so forth. So I'll show you that along the way. But Cassis is a beautiful little town with lots of restaurants and shops. You can see there's a castle in the background. You can see better in the other picture. And this is what you see when you board the boat, the cruise ship. So you have a little cruise ship that's going to bring you to the calanque. And the calanque is what you see. So all along the seashore where they bring you, you see these. So they've turned them now into beaches. They're kind of semi-private. There's a long walk. You can go through the inland and walk to those beaches. They're public beaches. But they're private in the way that they're difficult to access. So it feels very private when you go to a beach like that. But you can see how the structures of the stones are still there. And you can see it better. There were housing built even, but you can see how it's been chopped up. But it's a beautiful, beautiful sight. And then we went inland, back inland, up the mountain, and you see the Bay of Cassis, and you can see this beautiful blue water. So it's... It's really beautiful to see. Now, we are now on a hike on the Mont Saint-Victoire, so the mountain that Cézanne painted in his painting, we're on right now. So we took this two-hour hike through the mountain, and you see a dam from afar. It was just a gorgeous area to explore. So again, when you go to the south of France, and you do Provence, Côte d'Azur, Aix-en-Provence, all this inland area on the coast, you smell, you hear the cicadas, and you smell all these strong scents of flowers and herbs, and I can't reproduce that. It's a very unique, beautiful area, and there's this joie de vivre. So the south of France, another thing that you can eat in Nice is a zucchini flower dumpling. You see that on the street, it's delicious. The fish soup, and those are particularly to the south of France. Now, when you make your way to the Alps, which is what we are now doing, we are following the mountain range that is Alpes Maritimes. So we were in the Alps, but on the sea line, right, the coast. Now, when you go inland and you follow the range of mountains, you end up in the Alps. And so we are now on our way to the Alps. and we stopped at Le Lac du Bourget, and that's one of the biggest lakes that France has. It's a beautiful clear water. Again, the color is just striking. It's very, very blue, and it looks so clean. You can see the bottom of the water. It's see-through all the way to the bottom of the lake, so it's beautiful. And we stopped in Annecy, which is on our way to the Alps. Annecy is was a settlement, Gallo-Romain, so that dates back to the Gallo-Roman times, so the first century after Christ. So it's a very, very old settlement. You see very, very old buildings. And then you see that the river splits. There's a building in the middle. This used to be the jail. But you can see constructions that date back from the Roman times, churches that are very old. It's a very quaint town, and it starts having this feel of Germany and Alps, where the houses look very different from the houses that you see in Nice. And you have great restaurants, great cafes, golden age between the 16th century and the 20th century, so it was a lot of merchants, and it became a very popular destination. Because the economy just took off. And now we get to Chamonix. So Chamonix, when you talk about Chamonix, that's really in the midst of the Alps. You're not far from Switzerland and Italy. You're right at the intersection of the mountain range. The water that you see here was very cold. You could feel the cold coming from the water. This is ice melting from the top that makes its way. And that river goes all the way to Provence. It follows the range of mountains, and it feeds a lot of the water in Provence. This is high up in the mountain on the Col des Aravis. Chamonix, now totally different foods, different landscape. It's the mountain. It feels like it's much cooler, so you needed warmer clothes. The weather can change very quickly, can rain and then be super nice and sunny next. You see the mountain range around you, so the light, it's funny because Chamonix is known in the winter mostly for skiing because there's a lot of snow, but it is an all-season town. And the thing is, because of the way that the sun positions itself, it hides behind a mountain. Even though it's still daylight, it can get very dark in Chamonix. And the other thing that you see is a lot of cheese. So they have cheese fondue, they have raclette, they have tartiflette. All this is made with this gorgeous, beautiful cheese and heavy cream. So the food is very rich. Definitely very different from what you see in Nice. And then you can go, well, of course, these work mostly for when it's ski season. But you can see l'Aiguille du Midi. So that's the highest point in Chamonix. Near the Mont Blanc, right? That's part of the Mont Blanc. You see the Mont Blanc, and it's called the Mont Blanc because it stays pretty much white all year round. And you can take an excursion to see la mer de glace, the ice sea. Why is it called the ice sea? Because when you get to the top and you see of the Mont Blanc, this is technically all frozen. If you look at pictures that were taken at the beginning of the 20th century, you would see that the ice is all rippled. It looks like a sea, and hence its name, the Sea of Ice, because it looks like waves. Unfortunately, with the climate warming up and the problems that the Earth is encountering today, it is in global warming. You have the effect on the Alps as well. It's melting to a very worrisome speed because it's receding by 40 meters a year. It's an awful lot of receding. And so this is what you have today. But I'd be curious to see what happens in 10 years if we're going to see any ice at all. So the ice of sea is basically disappearing. It's one of the last I see that you can see all the icebergs, everything's melting, so it's sad to see them go, but this is as good as it gets to see the ice sea. So you see some of it in the back right there, the ripple effect, but it's pretty much going away. And this is the group that took the trip with me. So I wanted to point out that it was a great honor to take this beautiful trip with my students. And I have to give them credit because they took these French lessons before COVID, stuck with it through COVID, and then decided to go on this trip as a group. And we had a great dynamic because we knew each other very well. We all had done basically the French, the training of the culture. So the tour director complimented me how great this group was because they understood so much about the French culture, the way of life. And they're like, oh my gosh, I've never had a group so well prepared. We had worked hard for 2 years. So I want to tell them how proud I am of them and how I would definitely give them the title of ambassador, great ambassador of the year. While we were on that trip, because they showed curiosity and they used their French. It was just an awesome trip. So the trip in itself, the south of France, it's a beautiful area to visit. But when you are in great company, it makes it even better. And I think we had the best of both worlds when we took this trip. And I wanted to thank them. They have now become not just still students, but great friends. And so I hope that they enjoyed this presentation. Because it's just a great memory that we've built together that will last forever now. Nobody can ever take that away from us. So we learned before we went and we learned as we went, and they got to enjoy some of the things that I grew up with or that I knew from my childhood. And so this was a very, very special trip that I was willing to share with these wonderful ladies and gentlemen who are my students still today. And so I wanted to thank them. I hope you've enjoyed this beautiful trip with me. And maybe there'll be more in the future. I don't know. But in the meantime, look into the south of France. Definitely worth the detour. Have a nice evening, everyone.
Chemin mène à nous.
This is Kathy Young. Our family has lived in Hopkinton for about 8 years. So a couple of years ago, my kid pushed me to do the home composting. And I reluctant doing so because of the too much extra work. Of course, I got the lectures from my kid and we started doing it. And I'm really surprised that how much trash has been reduced just by simply doing the composting. 2/3 of my trash were gone. Since then, I got into learning about and advocating for the sustainability, and I joined the Sustainable Green Committee to work alongside others contributing into all this aspect. So I was really inspired by the new generation and welcome more young people join the efforts.